this is climate action in a time of crisis. And I think it's a very, very fitting title. We are truly in a moment of crisis in our national history and in our planetary history. I'm Lilly Lombard. I'll be the moderator for this program. This event was co-sponsored by 50 local organizations, and they're listed in your program. But I want to say special thanks to our host, First Churches. To AFSC for providing the sound equipment. For NCTV for filming and all of the media who are out here reporting on this important event. And for the Citizens Committee that organized to make this event possible. Can everyone hear okay? Okay, good. A few housekeeping points. Bathrooms are through this door and downstairs, or if you would like to use the women's facility, it's through Lyman Hall. You just keep going and moving left. There are clipboards that will be going around where folks can provide their contact information. This is a point of entry for some of you, and we want to capture who you are and your information so that we can keep in touch. So please, as the clipboards go around, make sure you sign up. We had trouble with the slideshow. It's not up now, but there was a slide presentation that one of our panelists, Dr. Marty Nathan, made, and a lot of you were not able to see the text. So we will be putting the slideshow on the Facebook event page for this event and also on the Climate Action Now website listed in your program. I would ask you to please make sure your cell phones are muted. Thank you. And we will be shortly passing around some baskets that ask for you to just drop a few dollars in if you feel able to. And that will go to support this meeting house, which has offered for 100 years a gathering place for our community and will continue to be a really important venue for bringing us together. So as those baskets go around, please consider all of the money is going to go to First Churches to keep this meeting house warm and accessible for all. Thank you. I just want to say a few words about why we're here. Look at this room. There must be many hundred people in here and more pouring in. 1.5 million, according to aerial photographs by the National Park Service. Why are we gathered? We're gathered because this is what humans do when we're under assault. We gather to affirm our sanity, to find comfort in each other, to face an onslaught of assaults to our empirical truth, to our basic institution of democracy, to our civil rights, and to our mothership, our only home, Earth. So we are gathered because we need each other now, and we're also gathered because alone we're one voice, but when we come together, we amplify our voice. We also gather because we need to hear from trusted friends and respected leaders. And finally, we do so because we want to act. We want to make a strategic act that is effective in facing this fire we're under. So for all these reasons, we hope that this event will satisfy your need to gather. And we have tried to create this event to satisfy all those points. So before we start with our panel discussion, I am going to introduce the pastor, one of the pastors of First Churches, Sarah Buteau, who's going to give us a short welcome.
I want to welcome you all to the Meeting House of Northampton. I want to let you know. All right, I don't know if that's going to work. Then I'm going to take Lily's seat. Turn the little mic on. Is that okay? Okay. All right. There we go. All right. All right. Welcome to the Meeting House of Northampton. I want to let you know that in this house, we believe in God because we are a church after all. But because of our belief in God, the people of First Churches believe that Black Lives Matter. We believe that women's rights are human rights. We believe that no human being is illegal, that science is real and water is life. We believe in religious freedom and that love is love is love is love. So welcome, whoever you are, whatever you believe, whomever you love, welcome and thank you. Thank you for giving your time and energy and heart to the work we are going to do here today. Thank you for giving at the door and into those baskets that this church might continue to do the work it does in the community. Over 600 people come through our doors every week, from the front steps to the basement, from the sanctuary to our little chapel out back. We host 12-step meetings, art and cultural events, environmental groups, peace and justice initiatives, homeless support groups, 4 congregations, and 5 worship services. Your support helps make all of that possible, and we are grateful. So welcome, my friends. Please settle in, but don't you dare settle down, all right? Because we have work to do today for the sake of tomorrow, and our work is more urgent than ever. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Here's a broad overview of today's event. So we're going to have a 45-minute presentation with our 4 panelists, and they're each going to speak 5 to 10 minutes. Then we'll have about 30 minutes of question and answer. Half of the questions have already been submitted by our co-sponsors. We invited all of the co-sponsoring groups to submit questions. We won't get through all of the ones that they asked. And the other half will come from you audience members. You should have received little slips of paper. If you haven't, we can provide those for you. And after the third speaker and the final speaker, we will collect those sheets of paper. And you can pass them to the far ends of the aisles, and ushers will be there to receive them. Then we'll go through as many of those as we can, and those that we aren't able to ask, we will compile and send in emails to our panelists and invite them to answer them and put them on the Climate Action Now website. After the panel presentation and the questions and answers, we will have a period of about 45 to 60 minutes for breakouts. So these are workshops or small group facilitated discussions on various topics you can find in your program. And this is the opportunity to build community and to go deep into the issues. It's one thing to show up for actions, but it's another to delve really deeply into some of these complicated, ambiguous, and challenging issues. So that's what we invite you to do in the second half. There's going to be a little bit of a delicate transition between the first half of the program and the second, so I ask your patience to maybe stay seated after the question and answer is over while we have somebody introduce how the breakouts are going to work. How does that sound to everybody? All right, then without further ado, I'm going to start with our first panelist. My great pleasure to introduce Representative Solomon Goldstein-Rose. Representative Goldstein-Rose is serving his first term as the Massachusetts State Representative for Amherst, Pelham, and part of Granby. At age 23, he is the youngest current member of the Massachusetts legislature, having run an election campaign whose cornerstone was making Massachusetts a leader in the transition to renewable energy. Interviewed by the Daily Hampshire Gazette just after the election, Solomon did not describe his against-the-odds victory as a dream come true. Quote, "My dream come true is ending climate change," he said. And can I just say that I actually cried when I read this? I cried. Solomon holds degrees in engineering and public policy from Brown University. During college, he founded and led the Energize Rhode Island Coalition, a statewide carbon pricing campaign. Now, just days into his term, Representative Goldstein-Rose filed four significant bills, including an energy jobs bill. You can learn more about the bills that he filed at his website, SolomonGR.com. Representative Goldstein-Rose.
Is this on? Yes, it's on. I think that's the nicest introduction I've ever gotten, so thank you. I grew up in Amherst since I was 8 years old, and I lived on a house at the end of a cul-de-sac off a long driveway in the middle of nowhere in the woods. And I grew up hiking and walking in the forest and developed this emotional connection to the natural world. I'm incredibly privileged to have had the kinds of experiences of walking on a frozen swamp in the winter and seeing a turtle beneath the ice, because as we learned in science class, water freezes from the top and allows the life to continue in the winter underneath. These kinds of experiences shaped my emotional connection to the environment and made me an environmentalist. And I have been an environmental activist since I was 12 years old, but I've increasingly focused not on environmentalism, but on climate change or global warming, and I use the terms interchangeably. And that's not so much because of the emotional connection, but because of the billions of people who are going to die from climate change if we don't solve it in the next 10 or 15 years. And that's a very rough estimate, because part of the problem is that it has a time deadline that we don't know what it is. And the goal is to avoid the kinds of climate tipping points that scientists warn us about, and we don't know exactly when those are going to happen. So it is urgent, it is a crisis right now, and it's also an opportunity. It's an opportunity for Massachusetts especially, because the only solution to climate change, the only full solution, is to develop clean energy technology that will be cheaper than fossil fuels. There is no chance that the world transitions from fossil fuels to renewables unless the renewables are providing energy cheaper for everyone. And we can do that. And we have done it in the US time and time again, developing new technologies. We did it with the Apollo project to put someone on the moon in less than 10 years. We've done it with the Human Genome Project, with DARPA programs that have invented radar and GPS and the internet. And these have transformed society in a matter of years, faster than we can possibly imagine government succeeding in transforming society, and yet we have done it. And we can do that in Massachusetts. So that is my goal. That's what the bill I've introduced is about. And that's going to be my top priority working in the legislature. I was asked to speak about the business side of clean energy technology and some hope that even given the national government, and I do think that with Trump's election, we have lost the chance of the federal government solving climate change. Everything else that Trump is going to do is going to cause huge problems and make life a lot worse for people for the next 2 or 4 years, but it will be reversible. In 2 years, we can take back Congress. In 4 years, we can take back the presidency, and we can change things back and make them better than ever. Except for climate change. The 4 years that we lose on climate change are irreversible. So that's why Massachusetts has to just go ahead and solve the problem on our own, and we'll be all fine. And we're going to do it. So the hope that I want to offer is that we don't need to do all that much. We don't need to, and we can't, plan out a whole system of how we're going to transition from a policy perspective. What we need to do is just open up the market to develop new technologies. Solar power and wind power have gotten exponentially cheaper in the last decade or two. Solar was pretty much initially developed in the Apollo program that I just mentioned, and since then it's gone from, you know, like $40 per kilowatt hour or something to 15 cents or something. Sometimes it's competitive with natural gas. It's always competitive with coal now in the US, and it's being adopted everywhere. The problem is that solar and wind are intermittent. The sun doesn't always shine, the wind doesn't always blow, so we need energy storage technology. And we need really cheap batteries because they will be useful on the grid and they will also be useful in electric cars. Already, an industry is going ahead. Tesla is developing lithium-ion batteries that are surprisingly cheap given the limitations of lithium technology. I'm interested in Massachusetts going forward with the next generation, the next generation of batteries. But know that no matter what happens with policy at the federal level, we're going to continue the transition to renewables because they are safer and cheaper and cleaner and healthier, and because it's already a better option to deploy a set of batteries than to build a new power plant for peak power. And in 5 years, it will be a better option to deploy solar with batteries than any new gas power plant. So. We're going to be okay. We just mostly have to push back against on climate and often ignore the federal administration now, and we have to be really energetic with what we're doing at the state level. So I'm going to leave it at that, and I'm excited to get to questions and hope many of you will join me for the breakout that I'm going to lead later, which is going to be on messaging and framing. One of the things that I think we often struggle with is how to talk about issues, especially with regard to climate change, in ways that people who don't share our particular values will care about. Everyone in this room, I'm guessing, comes at climate change from a somewhat similar perspective, and not everyone in the legislature or in Congress does, so, but we can learn how to talk to them in effective ways. So I will leave it at that for now. Thank you all so much.
How are we doing on sound? Is everyone hearing us? Okay, good, excellent. Okay, our next panelist is Dr. Nat Fortune. Dr. Fortune joined Smith College in 1994 as professor of physics. His research is on what leads experimentally to the transition from individual to cooperative behavior in electronic and magnetic systems, which, he remarks, could be relative in politics as well. Nat regularly teaches courses at the introductory and advanced level on energy, the environment, and climate change, as well as the physics of global warming. A resident of Whately, Nat served on Whately's school committee for 12 years and currently serves on its energy committee. Dr. Nat Fortune.
Thank you. The organizers have asked me to, in 10 minutes, manage to convince you about global warming. Nobody can hear me? Let me try again. Can you turn yours off? All right. The organizers have asked me in 10 minutes to share enough about the science of global warming that I can convince you it's imperative that we act, but not so much that I convince you that we can't do anything about it. And what's worse, I have to do this without using any alternative facts. But the truth is, we're in a remarkable window of time where our children's survival is not assured. But unless we continue, as long as we don't continue to behave as we have, neither is their demise. All right, the truth is that even if we stop emitting all carbon tomorrow, emitting all carbon dioxide, the Earth is going to continue to warm. And it's going to continue to warm for a century, perhaps a millennia. And it's going to do it for the same reason that you go to the beach on a hot, sunny day, because and jump in the water, because it takes a very long time for the ocean to mix and a very long time for the ocean to fully warm. So the choice we're actually offering you today is how much warming. All right, because even if we end all emissions tomorrow again, we will have as much warming as we have, again, as we have already had since the beginning of the Industrial Age. All right, we're a long way from ending emissions. We're a long way from reducing emissions. We're even just starting to toy with leveling emissions off. We had 7 gigatons of carbon going into the atmosphere at the end of George Bush W's first term. We have 10 at the end of the first term of President Obama. It's continuing to increase decade after decade. But right now, because in nature, carbon is part of a cycle, because nature absorbs carbon dioxide as well as emits it, it's often mistakenly thought that if we just level off emissions, we will stop global warming. And that's false. It's not even alternatively true. All right. The reality is that at our current rate of emissions now, even without opening a single additional pipeline, even without accelerating the supply in any way, just now with the emissions we already have, we are already putting twice as much carbon dioxide into the atmosphere as nature is able to remove. If all we do is stabilize our emissions, the level of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere will continue to rise and the planet will continue to warm. Now, this might be a subtle point. It's easy to confuse the rate of emissions of CO2 with the amount of CO2 that's actually in there, but it's the essential point of what I want to have to say with you. It's key to understanding what we must do and that it's actually possible to do something. So I want to introduce an analogy. I'm going to pick up on an analogy our moderator introduced earlier, the idea that we're a ship out in the open ocean. Now, the ship is our planet. Right? You saw that one coming, right? And the water, well, the water height is the amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. It's the level among the hull, the water line along the hull. If you like, go ahead and mark 400, 450, 500. For 350, get a Sharpie, it's underwater. All right, the ship needs water to sail. Our planet needs carbon dioxide to be warm enough for life. There's a number of different levels a ship could survive at. But if you're sailing, while you're sailing, you're actually actively knocking holes in the side of your hull. If you're actually punching holes in, those would be fossil fuel emissions. If you're doing that, then you're taking on water faster than you can bail it back out. You are not sailing. You are sinking. All right? And right now, in rough waters, the sea bobbing up and down, waves crashing over the deck, you won't notice the tipping point till you've already passed it. So that tipping point is coming. If you continue taking on water faster than you can bail it out, there's no way for the water not to continue to rise. There's no way for things to just work out. How am I doing with the encouragement side? All right. So, well, the bad news is that in the entire history of civilization, a transformation that was made possible by the advent of farming 10,000 years ago, farming made possible by the onset of a stable and predictable climate. Our global temperature has not fluctuated by more than about half a degree Celsius. All right? Now, it's in that relatively stable, predictable, relatively slowly changing climate. We've had farming possible, civilization has been possible. For all of recorded history, there's been a time to reap, there's been a time to sow, but that has not always been the case. We're now at 400 parts per million carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. The paleoclimate record, just the record alone, tells us that when we reach 450, and approximately 1 degree warmer than today, and approximately 6 presidential terms from now, make that 5, we can expect our planet to be as warm or warmer than it has been in the 200,000-year lifetime of our species. when it reaches 2 degrees of warming in the 500 level set by the Paris Climate Accord, the paleoclimate record tells us the sea levels will be 4 to 6 meters higher than today. That's 12 to 18 feet. Beacon Hill could become an island. That's not a good metaphor. So when we reach 550 parts per million, corresponding to roughly 3 degrees of warming in the short term and 6 in the long, we can expect to lose, and ultimately will lose, the northern hemisphere ice sheets. So here's the actual bad news. Somewhere along that warning path, yeah, you're right, okay. There's a tipping point. The tipping point comes from long-term feedbacks that amplify the amount of warming, as Rep. Goldstein said earlier here, as Solomon said earlier. Warming melts ice, the ice melting reduces the reflectiveness of the planet, that increases the amount of sunlight that's absorbed, warming the planet further. That continues. In addition, because you do that, you melt the permafrost, you warm up the frozen plant matter that has been there, it decays, releasing carbon dioxide and methane, another greenhouse gas you call natural gas. All right, in addition to that, the warming of the planet increases the moisture, the amount of moisture in the atmosphere, and water vapor again is a third potent greenhouse gas. If you amplify this enough, you must, in this kind of system, mathematically end up with a tipping point, with a thermal runaway, and that has happened in the past. So, what's the solution? If we've put so many holes in our ship that it's taking on water faster than we can bail it out, what's the solution? Absolutely, plug the holes. In the words of Margaret Thatcher, there is no alternative, you have to patch the holes. I'll be 1 minute over, I'm sorry. Professors are even worse than politicians. When it comes to reducing the burning of carbon fossil fuels, there's only one patch that can actually get us out of the predicament we're in, and that's to use less energy. That's to reduce the demand. The president can accelerate the opening of the taps, the accelerating the supply, but we control the demand. If you're serious, if I've succeeded here today, you realize that we have to cut our energy use in half in everything we do, and then switch the rest to renewables. Now, I know that sounds difficult. I know, are you serious? By half? Really? These two guys are gonna have to start commuting together. I mean, but here's the thing. Anything that exists is possible. We actually use five times more energy than the average person in the world, per person. We use twice as much as someone in Europe and Japan. So if for the sake of our children's children, we're willing to live as poorly, as miserably as the people in Edinburgh, London, Paris, Milan, Kyoto, Hokkaido. If we're willing to do that, we can reduce our energy use in half. And if we're willing to put up with the solar, the wind, the hydro storage that we will all see in lieu of the coal plants, the natural gas plants, the oil refinery that now only the poorest among us see, we can patch the hole. The one thing that we need to do is to realize that what I'm talking about is not alternative energy, it's imperative energy. There is no alternative.
Thank you. Okay, our next panelist is Dr. Marty Nathan. Dr. Marty Nathan, a resident of Northampton, is a physician, mother, and grandmother, as well as steering committee member of both Climate Action Now and the Springfield Climate Justice Coalition. She directs the Clinikita and Markham Nathan Funds. Marty writes a monthly column in the Daily Hampshire Gazette that educates and raises appropriate alarm about our climate emergency. She leads a neighborhood-based citizen group, 2 Degrees, that has demanded the repair of methane leaks in Northampton and beyond. Just this week, in fact, just 2 days ago, we were at a press conference for this, Columbia Gas announced that based on the information brought forth by citizens' groups in Northampton and Springfield, the gas company would begin immediate and aggressive replacement of grade 3 leaky gas pipes that, while posing little immediate safety risk, emit unburned methane, which has 80 times the heat trapping capacity of carbon dioxide. Marty's skills as a scientist, a diplomat, and a parent, and I'll just say this, she asked point blank the CEO of Columbia Gas, are you a parent? Are you a grandparent? And that moved that man, let me tell you. And her tenacity as an organizer are large part of what made this climate action campaign successful. Dr. Marty Nathan.
Thank you very much, friends. Can everybody hear me even in the balcony? Is it tinny? Okay. Thank you very much, Lily. It's a real honor to be here with Solomon and Nat and Stan, and we all have a different piece of this very complicated thing to give to you to digest and respond to. I'm going to tell you some of the same things that others have, but some not. I'm going to begin by saying that at this moment we are faced with a crisis only paralleled by the imminent threat of nuclear war that I remember very, very well when I was 10. In the early 1960s, when most of us children were envisioning the incomprehensible, the total destruction of the world as we knew it. Unfortunately, though this has gotten little press, that threat has remounted. And at the same time that we're doing what we're doing here must be taken very seriously. We are faced with a new administration that is filled with fossil fuel company CEOs and shills who are dedicated to drilling and burning every last molecule of carbon left in the ground in order to ensure corporate profits. Our situation would not be so dire if, as Nat has said, our Earth were not entering the phase of geological and climatologic feedback loops, albedo effect, that's white turning to dark, melting tundra, carbon sink filling, that mean that even should we stop emitting CO2 and methane, both those gases and temperatures would continue to rise. I want to say this clearly. We have no time to lose. We must stop emitting greenhouse gases now. This room is filled. It is amazing, and I thank you very much. But I also can say with great certainty that it would not have been filled a year ago. The country is waking up to the crisis at the same time that our best resource for fighting it, the federal government, is now fronting for the enemy. What to do? Several things. but they will require our commitment, courage, time, and energy, and a little bit of sacrifice. First of all, do not give up on the federal government. It is absolutely, if it is on our side, the best, most powerful resource to effect the massive energy, economic, and social transition that is necessary to put a stop to warming and environmental degradation. Protest the blasphemy and the carnage and the lies. Build the environmental movement by joining with all those who suffer from Trumpism, poor people, immigrants, people of color, workers, women, lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and queer people, disabled, and children. Our issues not only intervene, they interlock. The poor and disenfranchised are the first to suffer environmental degradation and the effects of climate change, and without empowering us all, we will never attain a truly powerful movement, and that's what we need. Support nationally important legal and regional fights. Example, the repermitting of the Dakota Access Pipeline and the Keystone XL is a disaster for all of us, and we must be willing to back up the resistance of those whose homes, culture, and livelihoods are affected by oil, gas, and coal infrastructure. Take to the streets.
Hear, hear.
On April 29th, come to DC for the second People's Climate March, or if you're unable, build a local action. Begin work now for the next critical election in 2018, when we must break the stranglehold that this fossil fuel industry has on Congress. But if now positive action is blocked on the federal level, organize locally and statewide to make this Commonwealth into a model for the rest of the country, and I don't want to get too arrogant here, the world in climate justice. Individual lifestyle changes are very important and necessary, but will not accomplish what we need. Join an organization that is working on what you think is important. I've joined three. Locally, we can push for rooftop and community solar and insulation, especially for low-income neighborhoods. Tree planting, thank you, Lilly, for what you do. And care, environmentally sound zoning, expanded public transit, streets safe for pedestrians and bicycles, and schools that teach about climate change and environmental sustainability. Be ready for direct action to prevent the building and extension of fossil fuel infrastructure. Ring a bell? The best example of resounding success is the blockage of the Kinder Morgan Northeast Direct Pipeline last year, owing to massive resistance by local folks, some of whom may be in this room. It's not over, folks. We have in Sandusfield an attempt by Tennessee Gas to build a storage pipeline through pristine Oda State Forest. Destructive, dangerous, and unneeded. Our resources should be going to conservation and the expansion of renewable energy. Which leads into a major topic that demands our attention. Using our citizen power to focus the Massachusetts state legislature on the most important task it has ever undertaken. Excuse me. Creating potent laws to stop emissions while establishing a just economy. I I urge you to spend time reading and understanding that 12-point plan that was handed out at the beginning. There is a table, a can table back in the back that you can fill out a letter, and there she is, there's Darcy waving. You can fill out a letter and send it into your legislator, to your representative right now, asking your legislator to support the packet of bills that CAN is supporting. We have a chance to build on and complete the framework of the Global Warming Solutions Act, but we must ask our reps to sponsor by next Friday. Send your email if you're not writing by next Friday. All of these bills are important. The first group are the policies necessary for the rapid transition to 100% renewable energy while focusing the derived economic development and green jobs on so-called gateway and environmental justice communities like Holyoke and Springfield. Included are rapid rise in the renewable portfolio standards and eliminating net metering caps on solar producers so that they can get a price for their electricity. There are bills that restrict future new pipelines and storage facilities, taking away from us the need to protest the NED and others, and to block biomass plant construction, like the one that has rearisen from the dead in Springfield in the last year. And support our new representative from Amherst, new bills for green tech and green jobs. There'll be a session on this following the Q&A. Go to it, learn more if you can. Sign up now with both CAN and Mothers Out Front. Mothers Out Front will send you a simple political task every Monday until we have a stable climate. Shall we live so long? There is a general CAN meeting every fourth Monday of the month at 7:00. Come, learn, take leadership. This is the fight of our lives, folks. But through it, we can not only literally save the world as we know it, but gain our common community soul. Thanks.
Thank you, Marty. Thank you for all you do. Our last panelist is Senate President Stan Rosenberg. I wish you were President Stan. Senator Rosenberg has been serving in the Massachusetts Senate for 25 years. Oh yes, thank you, Britt. Okay, so at this point, we're gonna collect any questions you have that you'd like to submit to the panelists now and then after Senator Rosenberg speaks. So if you have a question, you can move it toward the outside aisles and our ushers will be picking it up. Senator Rosenberg has been serving in the Massachusetts Senate for 25 years and as Senate President for the past 2 years. Throughout his career, Stan has fought for working families and our access to fair wages, affordable health care, and public education, for environmental protections and transition to clean energy, and for shared prosperity and fair taxation. As president, he has reformed the culture of the Senate by empowering and engaging his colleagues in a model he calls shared leadership, which encourages cooperation and participation. And I just like to say that as a constituent of Senator Rosenberg, I find him the most rapidly responsive elected official I have ever known. He answers emails personally, quickly, and thoughtfully, and he makes his constituents feel genuinely heard, and well represented. Senator Rosenberg, you're going to be hearing a lot more from us, so brace yourself. Senator Rosenberg.
Thank you. So, you're eating up some of your question time. So listen, I cannot begin without first saying that we should take a moment to recognize one of the people in the audience who, if the Massachusetts government had listened to him when he served in Solomon Goldstein Rose's seat, we probably wouldn't be sitting here today. Former Congressman John Oliver. John was our public servant and our neighbor for decades, and he was an early pioneering voice for the environment in the legislature, and we're deeply grateful for your service, John, and so great to see you here today with us all. And I also want to say this is a kind of deja vu moment for me, because 30 years ago this month, I served in the same position as Solomon, and in my first term in the legislature, I filed the first bills on the greenhouse effect. That's what we called climate change 30 years ago. So I'm very excited to see Solomon having such a passion for this and setting it out as his top priority, which, as we know, anybody from Amherst is supposed to have as their top priority education. Now, I'm sure it comes a second close priority to him, but he is right. All else is moot if we do not tame the carbon beast. And so I'm proud to have been in the legislature during a period of time when we made significant progress, but as I said on swearing-in day, we really have to redouble our efforts, and we have to speed it up. We created a climate change committee in the Senate about 14 years ago now, and Senator Mark Pacheco has been the leading voice on that committee for all of these years. And those of you who follow this issue closely, you're nodding your heads because you know that he is the person who has been the leading voice on this in the Massachusetts legislature, and he's actually known internationally and is brought all over the world to discuss what we've done here in Massachusetts, because although we do still have a lot more to do, we really, along with California, and in recent years we've exceeded California in the rigor with which we have addressed and worked on this problem. So we have some distance to go, and I have to say that some people have made comment already, or at least alluded to it. We have some very powerful opponents in this fight, because there are special interests who have strong economic interests in trying to maintain the status quo. And the status quo, if it's maintained, as Nate says, is basically a path to failure, and it will sink us before the end of not too much longer, really within a decade. If we haven't made substantial progress, we cannot reverse what is in the process of happening here. So last year we put through another piece of legislation, which happened at the end of the term, and like we did a decade ago, or a little bit less than a decade ago, we set out then to become a leading state in the introduction and use of solar in as many different ways as possible, and we are now the number one solar state in the country, notwithstanding the fact that we are a New England state and we don't have all that much sun, and yet we are the number one state in solar. And similarly, we became the number one state in energy efficiency a few years ago, and we've maintained that position. Although, again, we have a lot more to do, and as Nate says, it really starts with us, and it's shocking to me to know that the MassSave program, which provides free energy audits and some installation of some energy efficiency in our homes and businesses, still 30 years later, fewer than 25% of all of the residential properties in Massachusetts have actually been audited. And only about 10% have gone beyond changing the light bulbs and caulking the windows and the very simple, inexpensive measures of that sort. So we really have to step up what we do as individual consumers in our workplace, in our homes, in terms of how we use energy so that we reduce demand, as Nate has said. The legislation that we did at the end of last year moves us to in another direction in terms of alternative energy by setting up a very aggressive and robust program to try to do what we've done in solar with offshore wind. And that initiative, if it is as successful as solar, within 3 to 5 years we will have the largest offshore solar farm in the country. And we will not only have done that, but as Solomon is trying to do, we will create a substantial number of jobs because the tools can be manufactured right here. That is, the windmills and the engines can be manufactured right here in Massachusetts. So we get both benefits. My biggest disappointment in recent times around this is the fact that although we got the bill very late in the Senate last term, we added a substantial number of other provisions which unfortunately during the conference committee process and negotiating the differences between the House and Senate versions left a substantial portion of the other policies, some of which you are now pushing for in your package of 12 bills, should have been done last year, but they weren't done, and they were left on the cutting room floor. I am hoping that the introduction of people like Solomon, who is committed to this, and other millennials who have a sense and should have a sense of impatience about this, that they will help turn the House around so that when we send these bills over, we'll have support to be able to move them. I find it unconscionable that more than 100 state representatives signed on to a letter asking that there be the energy bill on the House side address the pipeline tax by making sure that no pipeline tax was added to the bill when the Senate, in its version, added a provision that outlawed it. It went to the House. In the conference committee, they did not accept that that provision, even though over 100 members of the House of Representatives signed a letter saying they supported that. That is unconscionable, and we need to really push forward and use the kind of activism that this recent election, with all of its disappointment, has now generated to make sure that when the people speak and their representatives try to speak, that their voices are heard and the actions are taken. So I'm going to stop here because I'm more interested in hearing more of your questions and being able to respond specifically, but the Senate will continue to have climate change as one of its top five priorities, another of which is income inequality, which we call shared prosperity, and so those two have already been mentioned, and the connection between poverty and environmental justice, and so we're going to continue to work in the Senate on a series of progressive initiatives, and certainly those two are in our top five. Thank you.
All right, I've been seeing some ushers go around collecting questions. If you have any other questions you'd like to submit, now is the time. We're gonna start the Q&A with questions that have been provided to us by our co-sponsors, and then we'll take some audience questions, okay? And I just wanted to give a quick shout out, because I'm realizing I forgot to do it in the beginning, to the Northampton High School Key and Environmental Clubs. They are out here ushering, they are showing up. This is our future. And again, whatever questions we don't get to, we will make sure that we compile and provide to our panelists, and hopefully they can consider those questions, and we'll post those on our website. All right, so we have a question from a member of the East Hampton Democratic Committee, Laura Garcia, who asks, there are many who feel that with the current administration's intention of reversing the Paris Accord, there will be little we can do as citizens to truly help prevent the demise of the environment due to global warming. What are the three most important ways we, as citizens of the Pioneer Valley, can prevent further destruction to our planet due to climate change? And maybe the way we can answer this, since she asked for three, is that each one of you maybe could take a stab at one. How about that?
Well, the important thing to remember is there are still parts of the world that do recognize global warming and climate change and did agree to the accord. That a country that seems to have not yet made up its mind, namely ours, however, is an incredible amount of leverage through our reduction in demand. Because remember that we're using five times more per person than an average person in the world, five times more per person than in China. So if we reduce our demand by 50%, it goes five times further than anyone else in the world. I can't resist saying, however, that the Paris Climate Accord target is too high, and that what the countries agreed to does not get us to that target.
Thank you. All right, so I think the take home there was conservation.
That's what I was trying to address. I think conservation on an individual level is really important, but unless we are organized on the local, state, and national level to both protest and give a positive program, then we aren't going to make it. And I don't think I'm disagreeing with you at all. And so I would say get organized. We have to organize for that imperfect Paris Accord. Demand our country uphold it. At the same time, we are making the transition through government and in our local communities.
I would second that and say specifically the big opportunity is going to be in 2018 in the elections. We can do all of the organizing and activism in terms of protests and trying to push existing members of Congress, but if we can get new members of Congress who are more committed to climate change as a top priority, in Massachusetts already our people tend to be great, but there may be open seats at the legislature level, if not Congress. We can think about those and certainly helping other states. So I would say political organizing for the elections in 2018 is one of the ways you can have the most impact.
Ditto.
All right, there you have it. Thank you. All right, this is from the Earth Ministry team of First Church Amherst UCC. Given that poor people and people of color disproportionately suffer the effects of climate change, how can their needs be prioritized in the steps we take in Massachusetts?
First thing is reduce the number of poor people. And the second thing is make sure that first of all, I don't think we're going to be building a lot more centralized power plants anymore, but to the extent that those kinds of big infrastructure projects are done, if the wealthier communities want them, then let's build those plants in their communities, not in the backyards of poor people who can't afford to buy the product.
And the converse of that, do clean energy construction and infrastructure projects that provide jobs for people in the Gateway and environmental justice communities. And we're going to change our communities, how they work. Particularly invest in those communities to make them safe, lighted, with good bicycle paths and pedestrian walkways and all the things, and housing is, there's conservation in housing and solar rooftops on top of all low-income housing, and you empower people. You make sure that they are in control of the process of the transition by any means necessary.
All right, thank you. This question is from Marty's neighborhood group, 2 Degrees. One big worry that climate scientists have is that Trump will erase all the climate data stored by the US government, which has been the place climate scientists all over the world evidently keep their data. What action can be taken to copy that data and store it elsewhere? Is there anything happening at the state level to protect climate data?
So I don't know that there's anything we can do about what they're doing at the federal level. We'd have to consult with our members of Congress to see if they could sort this out, because they understand how the federal government operates. But on the state level, you don't have to worry about us getting rid of the data. Yeah, there are a series of organizations and institutions that have been collecting and using and analyzing the data, and they're in the hands of universities and not-for-profit organizations that are not going to give their data up to be erased by anybody.
It's publicly funded research. We own it.
Yeah.
It's been downloaded. The challenge, however, is going to be, will we continue to fund research into global warming and climate change before? The reason we know that the tundra is melting is something we didn't know 10 years ago, right? Many of the things that we know that allow us to more accurately predict, many of the things that allow us to go and look back in the past are publicly funded. The satellite program offered by the United States is second to none. If you turn it off, you lose an extremely important window of time into what is going on. The solution, I suppose, would be to start writing your paycheck, your tax returns to other countries so they can launch the satellites.
Okay, I'll take a final question from our co-sponsors, then I'll start reading some audience questions. This is from Reverend Catherine Munns from St. John's Episcopal Church. How can the people of this gathering continue to support the communities who do not want pipelines going through their land? And I'll just add, that's a little bit of an addendum to a question directed from an audience member for Senator Rosenberg. How will you uphold Article 97 with the threat to the sands field upon us? Article 97 protects state conservation land, and Sandfield is under threat of, Sandusfield, sorry, is under threat of a pipeline passing through it imminently.
Sadly, we can do nothing more. The Article 97 provision of the Constitution prevents the transfer of land for non-conservation purposes. It's been challenged in the courts with regard to this pipeline, and the U.S. Supreme Court has ruled that, in fact, the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission's authority in federal law supersedes the Massachusetts state constitution, and so that battle is now over. I hope that boo wasn't for me.
No, no way.
The Attorney General took it all the way to the Supreme Court, and we lost.
We're stuck going that way, it appears. There is still a suit going on. My husband and I are part of that suit to prevent that storage pipeline. But also, I don't know if it's more important or not, but anyway, join the Sugar Shack Alliance, which is focusing on stopping with direct action, protesting and trying to stop infrastructure like this. And they are now looking at and have been working very hard on the Otis State Forest.
And there will be a breakout group after our panel presentation on that very topic. So look for that if that is compelling to you. This question is for Representative Goldstein-Rose. How can you encourage more young people to go into politics for climate action?
So, several things. One, 2018 elections, as I mentioned, are an opportunity. There were not many open seats in Massachusetts for the legislature this year. There are only 12 new reps coming in, and two of them actually unseated incumbents. But there have been classes of 40 or 50 reps coming in the past. So who knows what will happen in 2018? There is always the opportunity to identify specific open seats. I have just become the political director of the Western Mass Young Dems, and in that role, it is my job to recruit, identify and recruit, and train and support young candidates for any office. So I'm excited about that. Raise your hand if you are in the room and are under 30 years old.
That's good.
Nice. That's
great. Hey, this is way blows away typical turnout.
Okay. So if all of you want to email me after this, email my campaign email, solomon@solomonforrep.org, not my official email because it'll be about the Western Mass Young Dems, a campaign organization. Email me and get involved in that.
Can you say that again slowly?
solomon@solomonforrep.org. And come find me after if you didn't catch that. Yes, that's another way. There's a summit at Smith for young Dems, right, coming up. Is it the statewide organization that is having the summit at Smith? I know they sometimes have it in Western Mass. There is a summit anyway coming up that I should be more aware of, and I can give you the date. Yeah, it's the College Dems. It's the Massachusetts-wide organization, right? Yeah, College Dems of Massachusetts. There are several entities. College Dems of Massachusetts, if you're in college. Young Dems of Massachusetts, if you're any age and feel young.
Solomon, that's at 11 a.m. on February 4th.
Thank you.
Why do I know that and you don't?
It's in my calendar somewhere. The other thing is that there's talk of starting a PAC for young Democrats, both at the state level and at the national level. And I'm going to be involved in that. So talk to me if you're interested in that also. I would say, in general, thoughts, there are barriers to running for office as a young person, similar to barriers for running for office as a woman or as a low-income person or anything. We expect certain things of politicians, and we have certain demands on how you behave and how much economic security you need to have to begin with in order to campaign full time and all of that. So we need to specifically look for the next generation of leaders. It's urgent because the Republican Party has done this really well over the last 20 and 30 years. And while Democrats have been focused on the presidential elections, Republicans went and took over all the state legislatures, and they did it with a lot of young people. 13 young people were profiled in an article on the youngest state legislators nationally, and 9 of them were Republicans. So that's true even in Massachusetts. Actually, it's not true in Massachusetts anymore. We've just shifted the balance back with my incoming class. We've got 5 people under 30, all Democrats. Before that, it was half Democrats and half Republicans, which is not proportional for Massachusetts. So if you know someone who is passionate about climate change and young, tell them to run for office. It often doesn't occur to people. I didn't think I was going to run for office until I was working as an activist so long, pushing against the system and trying to get the politicians who were inside to do things that they really needed to do, and realized that I was going to have better chance if I was pushing from inside the system. And that was basically how I got into it. So there are many people who need that encouragement and need to have the support, both personal encouragement and the structural support of the Democratic Party and of organizers. If there are candidates on the ballot, both for state and national offices in 2018, vote for the young ones. Unless they're crazy, just vote for the young ones. Like, yeah. In 2020, if you get a 37-year-old candidate for president, let's vote for them in too.
All right.
Honestly, young Republicans are often quite good on climate change. So I'm more concerned about the need for more young people than the need for more Democrats, especially in Massachusetts, where Democrats have such a supermajority already.
Okay, so this is an open question to the whole panel. Are there any actions to nudge businesses to take action, especially businesses that depend on public opinion?
There have been various campaigns, and I'm not clear. Ken has taken this on to get support of particular actions in Western Massachusetts, and the Springfield Climate Justice Coalition has worked with businesses in Springfield to try to get the passage and the funding for the climate action resolution. It's an open field in general. There's just so much to do. It could be done better. Thank you, Shell.
Okay, Shell Horowitz in the back has some thoughts on that. Maybe join a breakout group on messaging, Shell, with Solomon.
Go ahead.
No.
Sure, I'll say something. There are various organizations that, like MassPurg, sometimes tries to pressure businesses. So they have had a campaign, actually, maybe still going, to get businesses to switch from antibiotics in their meats. That kind of thing can be very effective, pressuring businesses. But you need, I think, more people to be contacting businesses than you need to be contacting politicians to have an impact. Mm-hmm. For politicians, Ellen Story always said, like, if a rep got 6 calls on one issue, that was huge. They would pay attention. Not so much true, I expect, for businesses. But if the beauty of pressuring businesses is that if a big company like Microsoft decides to go carbon neutral, which it has, that has an impact because of their purchasing power, and they can then sort of force a new market for solar and wind and whatever. Microsoft, Apple, Google have all done things like that. So if there are opportunities, I don't have a specific company you should reach out to, but GE just moved to Massachusetts. That's an opportunity to say, hey, welcome. You should go big into energy storage development and deployment or something like that. They could wield a lot of power to do that.
I can add one small thing as well. It's a very good point, because when I say we need to have our energy use and we need to switch it to renewables, I don't mean just individually. I mean in every aspect of our life, from our food to our driving to where we work to who we buy from. And that means that you should be pressuring whoever you work for to do this and whoever you buy from to do this. Otherwise, it doesn't get done.
And I'm sorry, one more thing. TD Bank, boycotts of banks that do environmentally particularly egregious things. TD Bank supports the Keystone XL and also, I believe, DAPL. So there are the opposite, that boycotts are effective.
Stan? Okay. All right. I think we have time for 2 more questions. One very short one, and I think, Solomon, you've already answered it because you've given the entire audience your email address. But in the state, what is the best way to get in touch with legislators? It's been said that Fed reps ignore emails, take phone calls much more seriously. Is this true as well in the Commonwealth? And what if someone only has 1 hour per week or less?
I get very few letters or calls anymore. I get virtually all of my communication through email, and I read all of my own email, and that doesn't mean all legislators will handle it the same way. The most critical thing, though, is express your own thoughts and views. Don't just send us the stock email that an organizing group asks you to send. Personalize it with your own thoughts and experience, because as soon as I see the fifth or sixth one that says the exact same thing in the subject line and the first few sentences read identical, I then create one stock answer, and my staff then sends those out, because I'll get 300 of those, and there's no point in me reading the same thing 300 times, so they just handle those. But I read anything that is original, and I respond to most of those myself.
I will, yeah. That's actually better than I do. Me and my aide sort of like tag team at somewhat random the email, so I sometimes am personally responding, and sometimes she's responding with something that I have said. But I will also mention that I've gotten a couple paper letters, and those have an impact, because if you've taken the time to hand write a letter, that's impressive. So for those of you that do find that fun or have the time to do it, it doesn't need to be often, but that can have more of an impact because it's more effort on your part. And similarly, a phone call takes more effort on your part, less than an hour a week. You know, you take 5 minutes to get your talking points together and make a call. That shows that you care more than just clicking a button for an email. So I think that those can have more of an impact. I will also say, you can reach out anytime to meet with me and most reps in the district if you don't want to come to the State House, but also in the State House if you want to go there. And that's obviously the best way to get a message across if you have, you know, a whole message to get across. If you have one thing like, I want you to support this bill, just email it or make a call. But if you have ideas on things that people can be doing that they're not considering yet or stuff like that, set up a meeting and talk to them in person. Yeah, usually, I've met with people outside the district if they're, oh, sorry, she asked, is this only people in your district? Most legislators will respond to communication or meeting requests from constituents and not necessarily from others. I've met with people who are experts on certain areas or certainly organization leaders or things like that from outside the district, but mostly it's appropriate to reach out to your own rep.
I'm sorry, I'm gonna just hold you off there. We're gonna have breakout sessions and it would be a great opportunity for you to ask further questions then. So I'm gonna ask one more question.
I just can't resist.
Oh, I'm sorry, okay.
Perhaps because I'm not currently in elected office, I have the following suggestion. If they aren't responding to you, if you can't get in contact, run against them.
All right, good. All right, final question is, how can we sustain this energetic turnout for climate change and social justice?
One random note, you can subscribe to my newsletter, also at solomongr.com. I will have monthly updates on, yes, he is a wonderful newsletter also.
Talk to your friends and family as a starter, okay? Really helps. You can learn how. There's a breakout group. care for one another. Really important. These are tough times. Come to meetings. They really are not boring. We get things done. We create community. And we'll only do what we need to do if we're organized together. Make your daily life, fill your daily life with the politics as much as you can, and the joyous side of knowing that you are creating something new. That's what I can say.
And because we need to move on, I'm going to go ahead and wrap this up. Okay, thank you. I just want to leave with a couple of thoughts. One is that I went in the other night to Amherst College and listened to a presentation by a Russian-American journalist named Masha Gessen, who gave this piece of advice. She said, continue to be the hysteric in the room. Be the person that says, this is not normal. We are sinking. And so it means keeping that level of hypervigilance and panic, because we can sink into normalcy, and then we are finding that 5 years have flashed by, and by the time we get back a hold of that climate data, it'll be much more grave. So I know that's hard to hear, but that's where we are in our national experience and planetary experience. And I think the most effective way you can do that is to plug into existing organizations. This call for constant urgent actions is exhausting and it's demoralizing and it's not really sustainable. So this is why we are making this opportunity for you to connect with representatives from several different organizations who are working on climate change. They are down in the trenches doing the sometimes boring, to use the words of Rachel Maddow, who spoke in Northampton the other day, the sometimes boring, the sometimes tedious work, hard work of moving a project from beginning to end. So on that note, I am going to help us transition for a second to the next part of our program. First of all, I want to give a big round of applause to our panelists. Thank you. And I'd like to introduce